And welcome to the pre-show show. Brent is blinding me. I think he's waving behind all of those lights. Morning, which way are you going? Okay, wait, let's try not to completely remove our night vision. If you have just arrived and wondering what on earth is going on, you are in the behind the scenes point of a live safari. Bear with me one moment. Which way are you going to go? You're gonna wait and see where I go. I'm going straight to Inyala Road South. Okay, cool. All right. Morning, Gendre. Shame. Poor Gendre. He is not feeling very well. Oh, neither are my retinas after that experience. Goodness gracious. Now you'll see, for those of you wanting a behind-the-scenes glance, or you would have noticed, that Brent has got his rain covers on and we do not. We have taken a gamble, Viam and myself, as to whether or not it is going to rain. And Brent, immediately upon driving up onto quarantine, called me on the Game Drive channel and said, "You're going to regret that." So we'll see. We'll see. We might end up having to stop and put our rain covers on, but we have taken a chance. I think we're going to be fine, Viam. I think you're right. I think it was just mist. It's just a little bit misty. Maybe a little bit mizzly, which is a mixture between drizzle and mist. And we are on our way to the Queen of Juma, who was found as we finished our sunset safari last night. Our 1 hour shortened sunset safari, Rexon was tracking her and found her. Rebecca, who is directing us this morning, says it looks a little bit like we're playing follow the leader because, of course, Brent is right behind us. I will not be hurried, though. I will continue at my leisurely pace. Otherwise, I'm going to drive all over the tracks and get into trouble if Karula has moved, which I would prefer not to do. But she was found on a Nyala kill, on appropriately Nyala Road South. Don't see any footprints here. I don't think it rained anymore during the night, but of course we're all grateful to have woken up to another damp and soggy day, which might sound terribly sarcastic, but it's not. It's not in any way sarcastic, it's actually genuine, and I'm very glad that it has rained, and everything is going to explode in the next week or so, in terms of life and grass and leaves and things for the animals to eat. Right, so she walked, last night she walked along the drainage line and across through here, and hopefully, fingers crossed, apparently it's quite a small Inyala, which is unfortunate, but hopefully she is still around along with Shungile and Hosanna. Yesterday we spent the afternoon looking for her and found wild dogs. Well, we didn't find wild dogs, called into wild dogs. Wild dogs found us instead. Smell something. Okay. All the vehicle tracks are heading in this direction. Now, one thing about the damp ground, it's very hard to see animal tracks, but it is very, very easy to see where people have gone off-road. There goes Brent trundling along Batalia Road. That's not the Mulwati, Brent. You said you were going along the Mulwati. I'm devastated. Lots of Impala tracks. Nyala tracks. Will we find Karula before the start of show? We've only got 30 seconds or so. I am so good at timing, Rebecca. We have Rebecca and Kirsty in the director's chairs this morning, just by the way. The dulcet tones of Rebecca Christensen. I don't see any off-road tracks. If I missed her, that would be devastatingly embarrassing. And goodbye to our pre-show viewers. We have 5 seconds, and goodbye.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Wonderful to a beautiful, welcome one to a wonderfully beautiful cloudy morning. And now both Jamie and I are in search of Queen Karula, the dominant female leopard here on Juma. This is Safari Live. To the middle of the African bush. We're here on Juma Private Game Reserve. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Jandre on camera with me. And we are no longer looking for the Queen of Juma. And I'm not going to tell you why. We're going to go and maybe look for some lions. Let's see what's out and about on this beautiful morning. Now, this cool weather could mean the cats are on the move. Remember, this is 100% live, and you can ask us questions using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Now, I'm very excited to be out in the African bush. I'm one of those few souls who's lucky enough. Whoa! Oh, I missed it. It was a flying ant. To do what they love. Now, if the big flying ants are out this morning, and now a flying ant is an alate. It's the future of the termite population. Oh, that one's too high. Oh, off they go. That means we could be in for some treats, especially when it comes to the birds of prey this morning. And you often find them on the ground munching on the protein-rich termite. Queens and drones. Now, as I said, I'm not looking for Queen Karula anymore, and I'm going to let Jamie tell you why.
Well, Brent, it's not looking for Queen Karula anymore because we have found the magnificent Queen of Juma, and there ends my leopard drought since I first arrived back at work. Karula has stopped for a quick toilet break in the base of this dry riverbed. But as with any mother, you can't really do anything in peace when you've got little ones, and it looks as though Hosana decided to come and give her a gentle head rub. Shungile's here as well, but they are in a very tricky area, so we might need to do some shuffling about. This is the drainage line off Inyala Road South, and it's not the easiest spot to be in. Because we cannot, as you may have gathered from the sheer drop off to my right, we can't actually get down to her. And she looks as though she might actually be on the move. And I need to... Oh, my goodness. Oh, I don't trust the soil with the rain. I'd really rather we didn't go tumbling down there. Hey, little boy, look how big you've got. He's nearly as big as she is now. Her Karula's two nearly 10-month-old cubs now. No, 9.5 months old. Stalking quietly through the drainage line. Just bear with me a moment. Oh, apparently I completely forgot to introduce myself. That's the problem with these pre-shows, isn't it, VM? So a very good morning to all of you, and I'm sorry if you have just joined us and are unaccustomed to our chaos. My name is Jamie, and I have the wonderful VM on camera with me, and you are on a live safari, which is interactive, and you can ask questions, and this is the royal family of Juma. So my apologies for forgetting all about that particular aspect of this morning. I can only attribute it to my sheer excitement at having broken the leopard drought that I was in. Stump Haven. We might need to do some dodging. Come this way. This way. Oh dear. I need to just get hold of Brent before he disappears, because he is on the opposite end of this drainage line. He might be able to help us keep track of them. Where are we going? And is there a way down here? Oh, I see running spots. I think they're playing, full of the joys of the early morning. Ah, perfect. Thank you, Karula. That's the perfect spot to stop. And there is Karula, little Shungile at the back, once again showing her independence as she wanders around, exploring the world all by herself. Hey, gorgeous. I can't believe how much they've grown since I last saw them. What was it, about? Probably somewhere in the region of a month ago now. They have grown so much. There is the Queen of Juma, the 12-year-old leopard responsible for these little cubs, and I think we can all agree, one of the best mothers of the bush. I just want to see, before I get hold of Brent on the Game Drive channel, which is the way that we all communicate as guides, just want to see whether or not she decides to get up. I'm trying, at the same time, to work out whether or not I can get around and in there. Anything is possible, but I think not anything, not everything. I don't think we can get down there. Well, hopefully she decides to stay within view. I think I see her. Yep, I do. Flash of spots creeping up on her. Not sure which one that was. That was probably Hosanna, unless Shungile did some kind of magical movement that would have transported her to the opposite side of where she was going. Ah, the queen is up. The queen is moving. Brent for Jamie. Brent. Oh, goodness. All right, I need to do some chatting on the Game Drive comms and try and coordinate following these leopards with Brent. Let's head across to Steph, because we're not alone out here, and he is, of course, on foot.
A very, very, very good morning to you. Yes, and I am Steph, and on camera today we have Brian. And what we are doing right off the bat is having a look at a couple of dung beetles frantically trying to take a fresh pile of impala droppings down into the ground. This is a mated pair, for lack of a better word, I suppose, a couple, and they are trying to bury the dung as quickly as they can so that it doesn't get stolen by other dung beetles or infested with fly maggots. You will notice that there's a fly hovering nearby. That is the dung fly. There we go. I don't look like a dung beetle. Well, I suppose I do. It depends on what angle the sun catches my head at. And yeah, basically our plan today, the wind is dead still, and so we could pretty much walk in any direction that we want today. I don't quite know what direction I'm going to walk in just yet. I think I'm going to get to quarantine and decide what we feel like after a little bit of a discussion between myself and Brian and Herbert. But nevertheless, I suppose and I presume we're going to be seeing a whole bunch of quite interesting stuff, at least anyway, as we see here with this dung beetle pair. Just look at the pace. Can you imagine what's going through the mind of this dung beetle? I would imagine that the greater powers would have gifted it a sense of ecstasy, I suppose. I can't imagine the type of frenzy that we're seeing over here generated by any other feeling. They are putting this dung away. Obviously, both of them, you can see that there's no fight between the two of them. It's just get out of my way while I collect more. Make some space with some sand, stockpile it. And what they'd be doing is they'd be burying it at the bottom of the chamber. They will then lay an egg on the dung. The young dung beetle larvae would hatch and eat the dung, after which pupating and then emerging as a fully grown dung beetle a couple of weeks later. Just look at that. Now, don't forget that this show is interactive, so you're welcome to ask us questions as we go along with the bushwalk today. You can use the Twitter handle, the hashtag Safari Live, or you can send questions via email to questions at wildearth.com. Cape.tv, and we'll try and get through as many of the relevant questions as we can. As to why we're on foot, well, it's a good question that actually, considering we are walking around here in the same place that Jamie and Brent are driving around. Put it quite simply, for what you're looking at right now. It's very, very difficult to see the smaller stuff from the vehicle, and it also gives us a unique perspective and almost an animal eye view, really, that you don't really get from the car. That is just insane. You can see that there is some cooperation there. Why are they taking the dung away? Well, that's, I would like to say that they're programmed to do that, and it's to bury the dung. It enriches the soil. It gets rid of fly larvae and maggots at the top, which of course is a pest, and the flies are vectors for disease, so it reduces fly populations. It fertilizes the soil. It's just part of the whole cycle, the nutrient cycle out here. So Dina, you've just asked me, why can't they just kick the balls to the opening one after another, I suppose in a sort of conveyor belt method? Well, that's what they're doing. Watch here. There we go. So he stockpiles, or she stockpiles, and then when they've got enough, pushes it in with a face. That's just so awesome. And here we go. Let's see. Lindsay, you've wanted to know, how large is the underground chamber that they've made? Lindsay, it's more just a blind-ended tunnel than a chamber at the end, and probably about the length of your hand and a little bit. So let's say the length of your foot. So right now I can see some soil moving here. You can see how they've pushed the soil up. Here's the tunnel, and I can every so often see lifting here, so at least my hand width, probably a little bit longer than that, or a little bit deeper than that. It looks like they've now collected enough dung, and what I presume they're busy doing at the moment, you can actually see the soil moving here, what I presume they're busy doing at the moment is patting the dung into a pile so that they can lay their egg on it. You can see that the activity has actually stopped. The collecting activity has actually stopped. So I would imagine that they've reached a sort of critical mass of dung, or critical volume of dung. Oh, there's a tiny one there. Marco, you wanted to know if the dung beetle will lay one egg or multiple eggs on the dung ball. I think in this particular case it'll probably be one egg, Marco, because the larvae of the dung beetle needs a substantial amount of dung before it can have enough metabolic energy to actually pupate into a beetle. So the dung beetle larvae grub requires a volume of dung probably about as big as a tennis ball or a cricket ball before it will have fed enough and have collected enough nutrients to turn from a larvae, a type of worm type thing, into the dung beetle itself. So it takes a substantial amount. So it's probably just one for that volume of dung that we saw. How many eggs a dung beetle female can lay in a day, or in a month, or in a year? I'm actually not too sure about that. I would presume a lot. There's a lot of dung beetles around, and dung beetle larvae are the favorite food of a lot of different animals and get dug up all the time. So it would make sense for me that they lay, I don't know, several hundred, perhaps even several thousand eggs across a season before the dry season then finishes them off, or winter at least finishes them off. So I would imagine that it's a couple of hundred or a couple of thousand, but per dung ball of about this big, just one. All right, on that awesome opening that we had over there, it's set the stage for a cool walk. We've left Jamie sort of alone with those leopards for way too long.
Dung beetles, but I'm very happy that we started with leopards, and in fact I'm very happy that we started when we did with leopards, or else there's a very good chance we would have absolutely no idea where they've disappeared to. Now we've got Rexon helping us. He's moved into the area and he's on the opposite side of the bank to where we last saw them, and we have to go all the way around. Now unfortunately I'm struggling with my game drive channel at the moment. My game drive radio isn't working, so I can hear Rex crashing off road. I don't know if that means that he has managed to find her or if he's just on the search, but I'm just going to try and catch up with him to find out, because I can't, we're flying under the radar at the moment. I can't communicate with anybody. I'm just going to try and catch up with him on Batelier Road. Looks as though she's going to pop out. For those of you who are very familiar with the geography of this area, where she had those cubs in February, where Brent was fortunate enough to, he went down because she was behaving strangely the day before, and Brent went back to where we'd last seen her in this big thick sort of drainage line area, and then he noticed two very tiny bundles of fluff hidden in the depths of this drainage line. And that was the 2nd of February, when they were just a few hours old. And that, I think, is where she's going to pop out and emerge. There's Aubrey. I wonder if it's worth staying. Not really, because I can't hear anything. Come on, Queen. Don't pull a magical disappearing act on us. This is such a nice weather for a cat sighting. They're going to be playful, full of energy. One of my favorite, well, it is my favorite type of weather to actually watch cats in. Oh, hold on. That way. Sorry, everybody. Oh, thick sand, thick sand, thick sand. Ooh, 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 ooh. Hi, guys. Okay, let's try and follow on behind Rex. Bex, if I can just ask you to tell Brent to tell the guys on the Game Drive comms that my radio's not working. Because I think they've been trying to call me, and I don't think they're terribly impressed that I haven't been answering. Oh, there we go. Leopards! Carilla stopping to scent mark one of her favourite leopards, and the little one's moving along behind. And this is why it's always wonderful seeing the tracks that these three leave behind. You can see Carilla sort of walking in a relatively straight line on a mission, and then the cubs crisscrossing on top of her tracks, bumping heads with her, rubbing up against her, and just generally feeling thoroughly playful. Now the queen has settled for now, which is great news. Fantastic. And we do, of course, have Rex to thank immensely for his help and for actually finding the three of them yesterday. What a gorgeous spot to see leopards in. Okay, let's go forward a little bit so we can get a better view. Catch up with all three of them. One, two, and three has vanished. Oh, there she is. Watch this, watch this. Shungile is stalking her brother. Look at that. Isn't that instinct amazing? Sorry, Shungile is stalking her mother, not her brother. Yes, you're invisible. I am an invisible predator. I'm going to catch you. Amazing, this instinct. How sweet was that? An aborted pounce. A moment just to spend with Mom. and have one jolly good cleaning and de-ticking. I absolutely love sharing these moments with these leopards. She's nibbling away at the fur of her neck. The perfect scene of mom and daughter. I hope you're taking lots and lots of screenshots because we're going to use them to track the growth of these cubs. Oh, just bear with me one moment. We might need to shuffle around. There's not much space here, and I just want to make room for Aubrey, who's also come into the sighting. But short of driving into the back of Rex, that might be a little bit of a struggle. And then, Roger, I will get round to answering your question on the tales and greetings. Hassana, not content with the amount of attention his sister's getting, has decided to come and join in. There you go, Roger. You wanted to know about leopards lifting their tails when they greet each other. To an extent, yes, they will, but a lot of the time what they actually do is use their tails to gently brush against each other's faces. Ah, what a perfect trio. So what they'll do is they'll flick their tails upwards, and then you've seen it now with the two cubs as they've gone up to greet their mom. They rub heads with her, and then their tail sort of wraps and knocks her in the face. And we see exactly the same process with mating leopards as well, whenever the female is trying to attract the male's attention, albeit with completely different motives. How's that for a fantastic bush scene? Leopards on the move with the sound of a cuckoo in the background. Of course, well, it seems as though we are thoroughly spoiled for choice this morning, and Brent has managed to track down and find some more big cats for you.
Well, we're with the incredible Inkahuma Pride of Lions, our main lion pride. It seems like all five females are here, and one Birmingham boy, and at the moment we can only see four cubs, but others could be around. Now they are looking quite angry. Who knows, they might get up and get on the move this morning. Can you hear an impala alarm calling in the distance? I'm not sure whether it's alarm calling at these lines. Oh no, it looks like it's time to go back to snuggle weather. It is sort of duvet weather this morning, and the lions seem to be thinking exactly that. It's a good time to snooze. No. One of the cubs sleeping there. How many are there? Three there, Jandre.
And then the fourth suckling.
And then the fourth is suckling behind the bush. Is that impala alarm calling? I wonder if that it's not one of the other Birmingham boys around. Right, there's, I can see the impala. I want to see where he's looking shortly. So there's the impala there. See if he looks towards us and snorts. See, he is looking in our general direction. I don't think he spotted those lions unless they were standing up. And the squirrel's also going, and I don't think the squirrel's going to be able to see the lions from here. I might just go have a quick look there just now. But if we look right down right next to us, the amber-eyed lioness and one of the other females are very snugly sleeping together there with the Birmingham behind them. Now, Someone just asked whether lions or other big cats dream. Kola was wondering that. Now, Kola, they do. We do see them dreaming, very similar to what dogs or cats dream. They're probably chasing buffalo in their sleep, but probably not as common as it is in domestic animals. Oh, isn't that just too sweet? Guys, I've just heard Jamie's having problems with her game drive radio, but it sounds like Karula's just caught something. So I'm gonna just try and get hold of her. Okay, so I'm not sure what's going on. I'm just hearing on the game drive radio. We've got sleeping lions here. It sounds like Karula's on the move. We'll just see what happens. Now, there's squirrels and there's impala alarming behind us. Quickly, quickly across to Jamie.
Now, for those of you that are sensitive viewers, please turn away from your screens now. I'll tell you when it is safe for you to watch. Karula's just now pounced on a baby Nyala that she's managed to catch. She snuck up on it. It's still alive. It is still fighting and still kicking. But unfortunately, the poor little thing really doesn't stand a chance. Now look at this. Look at the behavior of the cubs. It's coming in to try and help. Look, it's hissing at Mom. It wants to try and help. Karula knows. There we go, look at that. And she's left it. And this is how young leopard cubs learn. A very difficult sight for us to watch, especially where a little baby antelope is concerned. But it just goes to show the incredible power of Karula and how skilled she is as a huntress. 2 seconds ago, she was walking along this dry riverbed. The next thing we knew, she'd caught something. And look at this, the cubs just killed it. Oh, no, it's still alive. And this is where it is going to get really difficult to watch, because this little leopard cub doesn't know exactly how to go about this whole process. The instinct is there, but the jaw strength and the technique is not. He's hissing now. I think he's hissing at his sister. This is the way that leopard cubs learn. It's very difficult to witness, though. It could well take him quite a long time to kill this baby Nyala, but it is how he's going to learn, and it is how he's going to master this technique. And what you're watching is such an incredibly important moment in these cubs' lives, and how fortunate are we to be able to share in it. Just doesn't quite know what to do. He hasn't mastered that stranglehold. The instinct is there, especially when the Nyala moves. And what you're seeing right now is the very first time we've seen Hosanna with a proper kill. Come on, boy. Use those instincts. Dispatch it quickly. That's it. That's what you need to do. Now he's dragging it up out of the way. That's also a very, very important instinctive technique to make sure that this kill is safe. I'm just going to go forward ever so slightly just so we can keep a view of him. Oh, hold on. He's still dragging it. He's taking it up onto the drainage line wall. His mom and his sister have just giving him the space to do what he needs to do. And hopefully that's it for the baby Nyala. And well done to Karula for providing for her cub. Both of her cubs. No, don't do that. Ah, he's just going round the other side. Now actually practicing hunting techniques as well, in terms of the way that he goes about pouncing on it. And all of this under the very close and watchful eye of Mom, who's keeping an eye on what he's doing. Oh, what an incredible series of events, from Karula catching the Sinyala to the movement of Hosanna moving in and hissing at her, and the fact that she did just leave the Inyala to him. So she knows that this is something that he has to learn. I'm relatively certain that the Sinyala's dead. I think he actually broke its neck as he pulled it up in, along with him, into the drainage line wall. And it just goes to show the power of these animals, that at 9 months old, they are capable of killing something like an Inyala, even if it is a little one. Now what he's doing is he's basically like a cat with a mouse. He's playing with his food. And that's essential. It's the way in which they learn the weaknesses, the strengths of the bodies, where the neck is, how the legs work. It's all going to play a vital role when they're hunting and subsisting by themselves. And look how excited he is. That's an expression that some of you will be very familiar with. Those of you with cats, and even with dogs to an extent, when they get overexcited and they have that moment when they hunt something, that bright, hyper-excited expression in their eyes. I'm sure many of you will be familiar with that with your pets. With your cats, when they play with something, particularly with cats. Oh, goodness. Not quite secure on your footing there, mister. Okay, Aubrey's just going to move in front of us. He did ask for if we would mind. And Jay Atkinson, you say he has learnt a pretty fast and well done Hosanna. He has, hasn't he? I'm just trying to think about the best way to go about this. I think we need to go up onto the drainage line itself. Let's just watch for a moment from here, see where he ends up. Thank goodness this Nyala is no longer alive. At least he managed to kill it relatively quickly. But you're right, he has learned unbelievably fast. They both have. And this could easily have been Shungile in her brother's place, and probably has been at times when we haven't been around to witness it. And now as the older the cubs get, the more they move with their mother, and the more they have these opportunities to practice. That very typical leopard hold, we've seen them do it so many times in the past, putting the prey between their legs and then dragging it along the ground. Well done, Hosanna. And sorry to the little Nyala that I have a suspicion might have been that one that Brent saw in this area a couple of days ago. It's a very, very tiny baby. Only a few days old and unfortunately just not experienced enough in the ways of the world. Okay, I'm going to reposition. I'm going to go up onto this mound of soil. What a way to start off a day. That was not what I was expecting. I was expecting Karula to start moving her cubs away and off to somewhere different, away from the kill that she'd had. I did not expect her to grab an Inyala at that speed. Oh, we definitely know it was Karula that caught it. We've been very fortunate to be around to witness these milestones in these cubs' lives. And we'll be looking back on these moments years from now. Just think, years from now, when Hosanna is all on his own, catching his own food, living on his own and establishing his own territory. What do we think, Viam? Forward or should we stay here? I think let's stay here for now. Amazing. Now don't lose interest, mister. You've got work to do. You can't leave everything to Mom. You've done some of the dirty work. Now you've got to set about opening that carcass. And with full bellies, they're not in any kind of a hurry to actually feed off it. keeping us guessing. It's almost like every time we get a camera on him, he moves behind a tree. That little tail twitching. Amazing. While we wait for Hosanna to move into a slightly clearer area, let's head back over to Brent so he can update you on his morning. Perhaps it's as exciting as mine.
Okay, so we've been going through some distressing stuff with the lion cubs, and the fact that I only saw four with the pride made me come to where they were yesterday. And if you are sensitive, now is the time to, as James would say, go get a cup of tea, look away, turn down the volume. The sight itself isn't gruesome, but it is quite difficult. The second cub is definitely down now. Although we thought the first cub was with a broken back, it's probably more than likely disease. It's just too coincidental that two cubs showing very similar symptoms have gone down. We will notify the correct people and the management, and they will decide what to do. So we're not going to stay. We're just going to have a quick look, just so everyone knows what's going on. We're not trying to hide anything from anyone. So we've come back to where we were yesterday, and there's a second cub down. I'm going to keep looking for the other sort of two that we didn't see this morning. But there have been outbreaks of disease, and it could also be a genetic disorder. I've heard of pride of lions in the south of the Sabi Sands, where all the cubs showed very similar symptoms to this, but it was a genetic disorder, and as soon as they got to about this age. So there we go. That's all we're going to do here. We're going to move on now. And do send in your questions, and I will do my best to answer them. And of course, some answers I don't have yet, because we're going to have to notify the correct authorities and the state vet and all those type of things. Now, a lot of you might not agree with what the decision is from the Sabi Sands management, or from the and you must remember, they don't make decisions by themselves. They consult the state vet, they'll maybe consult Kruger vet, and there's a lot of stuff that goes on that a lot of people outside of the sort of professional wildlife world, specifically when it comes to veterinary and stuff like that, there's a lot of decisions that are made that might not make sense to the general public. Now, put it this way, the Kruger and the Sabi Sands and that have been going, or Kruger's been going for over 100 years. So they are probably, and also they are almost certainly the best run national park, if not in the world, in terms of research, biodiversity, and all that type of stuff. So even if we sometimes disagree with their choices, we really have to just take a seat back and realize that they're working off 100 years worth of data. We're working off what we're seeing in front of us. So there's a lot of stuff, and we will try keep you updated, and I will try get the most current and best information for you as soon as I get it. So I know it's very difficult, especially since we've watched these cubs grow up over the last 6 months. But again, this is nature, and diseases have plagued lions for as long as there's been lions. And it's as difficult as it is for us to see that, and Michael's got an interesting observation. He says, do I think tick paralysis could have made the cubs paralyzed? It could be a tick-borne disease, and if you look at some of the lions at the moment, they've got a really big infection of ticks. Sorry, Jean-André, our aerial's fallen down. But as I said, Michael, I'm not going to start guessing, because as soon as you guess, you get into trouble. We'll just let the right people know, and then as soon as I or any of us here at Safari Live have the correct information and we know a little bit more, you will be the first to know. Oh, well, I know it's so difficult, it's so sad, but and there's not much we can do about it. I'm going to go back to where the rest of the lions are now. I'm going to have a careful look around there, see, hopefully, fingers crossed, the other two cubs are still there. We just couldn't see them from where we were. And it is very sad, but if you look at lion population in a stable lion population like we're in here in the Greater Kruger, there are always ups and downs, ebbs and flows. Now, I'm not going to make any guesses. I'm going to wait till we know for sure before we start speculating, and often that type of stuff, as I said, you speculate and you're wrong, and we start, people start getting the wrong information, and in an age like we are in today, that information can spread like wildfire, even if it's not correct. So I'm just going to wait till we get the right information about what's going on, and then from there we will tell you immediately. Now, we're going to head off towards the rest of Nkuma Pride, see if we can see where the missing cubs are. While we do that, Steph is tromping around in his size 11s somewhere out in the bush.
And just on a slightly easier note, we've got the flowers coming out from spring. This is a peltiforum, a weeping wattle, and we are... oh, just enjoying the perfume and the good vibes that come from a flowering plant. This is one of the showier plants out here. As you can see, every one of these little dots will eventually erupt in that yellow flower that you see, and probably flower for a couple of weeks, attracting all manner of bug. And I really can't wait to see. Last year, these peltiforums were an absolute hive of activity. Everything, for every colored fruit chafer we could find was on them, bunch of different beetles, bunch of different weevils. It was just really good. And I've been carrying around this as well for the last couple of minutes. I dearly wanted to show you what this is. This, it's called a white head. I can't really remember the scientific name for it, to be quite honest. It's just been a whole season of other things going on in my head. But the bushmen used to collect this, just like this, the whole plant, and they used to store water in ostrich eggs in caches in the bush. Because water is quite a poor resource, they used to take an ostrich egg, drill a hole into the top, eat the contents, and then fill the ostrich egg with water when they found it, and then bury the ostrich eggs. And to keep the water fresh, they used to stopper the egg with this. And not only does it impart a very pleasant taste to the water, but the roots contain an antimicrobial agent. So it actually keeps the water from going stagnant, and it keeps it fresh for much longer. But it has the most unbelievable smell. It is a cool, refreshing, minty... what's that wintergreen methyl salicylate is the compound, wintergreeny mintiness. Oh, it's just such a fantastic smell. It's like what did we say, what emotion are we talking about here, happy. Mr. Brian, it's a happy smell. Yes. Oh, I'm going to carry this one around with me for a little bit and just sniff it from time to time to lift up my already good mood today. It's just been a really epic walk so far today. We haven't even gone far. Maybe only 300 or 400 meters from camp. All right. We have decided that we're going to be walking west today. We haven't walked west in about, well, I haven't walked west in about 3 weeks. And so we're going to go and see what is happening around the Sandy Patch, Aubrey's Road, perhaps even get as far as Sydney's Dam, potentially. We'll see what goes on when we get there. Not too far a walk, I suppose it's about 2 miles, 3 miles from camp. So by the time we get into that area, we'll be a decent way through this walk. And on the way, who knows what we're gonna see? More happiness. Ah. Really, really awesome. So just to describe it again, it's like when you first smell it, it's almost like a peppermint. And then the smell sort of changes to a minty, a wintergreeny smell, and then it ends off this quite sweet goodness. Don't quite know how to explain it all. There's just too much going on. I could bottle this stuff, really. Really nice. All right. Now, let me just get myself under control over here, because we are going into some thicker bush. And of course, we just need to make sure that nothing is standing in there before we just march through here. These types of bushes get this canopy that's sort of at eye level that make it so difficult to see through. And so what you don't want to do is just go marching through there. It's always a good idea just to take a knee and look and see if you can see any movement at this level. The leaves start a little bit higher up. I'm going to sneeze. I'm going to hold it in because that would definitely... There we go. I'm just warning you, I might sneeze into the microphone just now. I'll try and do it away. Too much sand in my face. All right, no movement just yet. It looks safe enough to go through. You sometimes get a bit blasé out here when we get carried away and we forget that we're just surrounded by sort of herds of buffalo, elephant, rhinoceros, hippopotamus, lion and leopard. And sometimes it's just a good idea when we are walking around here to just ground yourself before going into a potentially dangerous area and just take it a bit easier. All right, I'm just gonna move this out of the way for Brian, who is already about 7.5 feet tall with another 7.5 feet of aerial on. He makes for quite a formidable path choosing. There in the distance, you can see Herbie. You're okay, walk. In the distance there, you can see Herbie. It's a three-man team. If this is the first time you're joining the bushwalk, it's a three-man team. Myself, Brian, and Herbie, and it's Herbie's job to keep a lookout while we are engaging together in the screen. As you can see with me marching backwards and having one of my ears full, it's sometimes quite difficult to keep the type of, almost trip over the tree, to try and keep the type of alertness that we have. And so we work in a three-man team here, and it seems to be very, very good. Although we've had many, many hundreds, I would say, of encounters over the last year and a half, we're quite lucky, touch wood, we haven't, touch a bit of wood, we haven't had, we haven't had any dangerous encounters, any life-threatening encounters yet. Which is a good thing. All right. I think Brent has moved on from where he was, and he's dying to give you an update.
So we have moved on. We're just checking very carefully. I've got the tracks of the pride coming down the road here, and I'm just making sure that there are no other cubs sort of on the way. I'm heading back toward where we found the rest of the pride. I'm going to go have a much more careful look now at maybe below. Maybe there were cubs we couldn't see. Maybe that's what the impala and the squirrels were alarming at. Now, more than likely, as I said, I'm not going to speculate, more than likely, if it keeps going, one of the carcasses of those cubs will be collected, taken to the state vet, and they will do a necropsy of the cub to try to figure out what's wrong. And depending on what's wrong will depend on what they do from there. So as I said, as sad as it is, we can't jump to any conclusions just yet. Let's just wait and see what happens. Was a bit bigger. Now actually something really funny happened last night to Brian and myself while we were off air. So after that incredible lion fight, I've got my sneaky spots that I use for crossing riverbeds, and I've used this one spot many times. And because of the rain, it's obviously made the soil a bit soft, and unbeknownst to us, underneath was an artfork burrow, a disused one, fortunately. And we were driving, the ground looked exactly like this, perfectly fine, and off we went, and we just went boom. Now we're back with the lions. We're trying to see, we've come from a different angle to try see if we can see any more cubs. So see, there we go. So we've seen four, but there looks now to be two or one hiding under the bush, so that's five. He's really hiding under there. So as I said, I think it's quite likely the other six cubs here now, and I think it is better to know than not to know where the others are and what's their state. So we're not going to be spending time with those injured and or ill animals, but we will keep you updated on what's going on. Okay, let's go around so we can see the rest of the pride. The authority looks worn out after his boxing match last night. Now, of course, when you hear me say the authority, I'm referring to Mfumo, who's one of the Birmingham boys. He's that one, the one we see the most often. You can see he's got that wound on his face that is healing up really nicely. And he had a fight with one of the other Birminghams. It was so quick, I unfortunately didn't identify which was the other one he was having an argument with. Sleepy lions. They haven't moved far. They've probably moved about a mile from where we were with them yesterday. Unfortunately, if we look at the moment, these cubs, these two in particular, look very healthy. Now, one of the problems with social predators is that because they spend such a lot of time in close proximity to each other, it does make it much easier for certain diseases to spread through a pride or a litter of cubs. Now, it's difficult to say whether those two cubs are from the same litter or not. I would say they look to be similar age, but we must remember six of them were very close in age. Hello, Fluffy. Has he got a nice stick as a pillow there? Yes, he does. He's having a little scratch on the stick. Oh, a little yawn. We must just remember how privileged we are to be able to spend as much time with the lions as we do, and we get to see the best and worst of the life of lions. And a lion's life is not easy. It's really tough out here in the African bush. I mean, the best way to explain that is, I mean 70% of all cubs die before a year old, and it's good lick. Self-grooming, not allo-grooming this morning. And if you look at the age that adults live to in captivity, they'll live over 20 years, and in the wild, males 12 years and 15 years for a female. There we go. I'm just going to move around, see if we can have a bit of a better view from the top side. Now, hello, Cindy in Tennessee. Cindy is wondering, do the lionesses know which cubs are theirs? And The reason Cindy's asking that, for those who are not sure, is that lions practice allosuckling. So lionesses will let cubs that are not born to them, but are born to the rest of the pride, suckle from them. Yes, Cindy, almost certainly they do know which cubs are theirs, and if those cubs do die, they will come into estrus quite shortly after that, sometimes as quick as sort of 10 days after the cubs have died. Now, with other cubs around, that might suppress that a little bit. It's difficult to say, but normally, yes, they will come into estrus quite soon. Okay, well, we're gonna get into a good spot with these lions. While we do that, Steph's got a horse who forgot to take off his pajamas.
Well, it's a bit wild, horse, standing next to a not-so-wild telephone pole, or electricity pole, I should say. It is a Burchell zebra, or plains zebra, and quite a skinny one, I must be honest with you. You can see it's standing facing us now, and by skinny I mean the forequarters, the chest. There you go, from the side you can see zebras are never really skinny. Oh, they're just the most bizarre animal in a green patch of bush. I mean, why would you be black and white striped amongst greens and browns and greys? There's a lot of speculation as to why zebras have those stripes, and are they black horses with white stripes or white horses with black stripes? If you have a look on the inside of the leg, the inside of the front leg, it's white in the armpit, and the stripes sort of come onto the white. So I would like to believe that a zebra is a white horse with a black stripe rather than a black horse with a white stripe. But I suppose it's up to interpretation, whatever you feel like, really. As to why they have stripes, most of the wild horses in the world have some degree or another of a stripe, including the baby horses or young horses have a stripe. It's just thought that the zebras of Africa have evolved this bold patterning for a bit of disruption. It's very difficult for a predator which sees in shades of grey to distinguish one animal from another when the animals are moving so fast. And you can see it on the plains of East Africa in the Mara, where lions are confronted by thousands or hundreds of zebra crossing at a crossing, and you will see that they'll battle to pick out one. They pick one and they pick one and they pick one, and zebras just stream past them until one animal is left alone, and that one usually gets targeted. So I think it's a bit of disruptive patterning. Secondly, each of the zebras have its own unique stripe, and the babies are able to key to that stripe, and the mother is able to key to the baby stripe. Either of the party gets lost, they can find each other amongst thousands just by keying to that specific pattern, which is quite amazing. And then on a physiological scale, I suppose, zebras have a lot more blood vessels in their black stripes than what they do in their white stripes, and it's thought that with the light reflecting off the stripes, off of the white stripes, the white stripe is cooler than the black stripe and creates a bit of a heat sink. In other words, it's a way of cooling down. Zebra, very rarely you'll see zebras lying down in the shade. Normally they're standing in the open, quite happy in the hot African sun, and it's nice to think that there's some other type of scientific explanation other than just you look nice for those stripes, but we really don't know. There's a lot of different theories about it, and I suppose you just pick the one that you like best. Really, I'm still holding my white-headed bush. Oh, yeah, it's still generating happy feelings. All right, we're gonna be picking this game path to walk on. This path here, very, very prominent game path, leads all the way to Sydney's Dam, and that is exactly where we're going to be walking to on this path, and updating you as we go along. But for the meantime, we're going to be sending you through to Jamie, who's got an update for you.
From stripes to spots indeed, and we have managed to reposition ourselves and found a slightly better viewpoint to watch the amazing royal family as they go about their day-to-day business, although I have to say As unfortunate as it is, I have to say that the joy of the sighting is dimmed slightly by the tidings that have come from Brent about those lion cubs. Fortunately, though, the leopard cubs are happy, healthy, and thoroughly enjoying their morning. Hosanna has spent the last few minutes snarling at his sister and his mom before he had a minor rest, because he's obviously exhausted himself with this display of athletic ability and energy. What are you doing now? You crazy thing. It is extremely touching to see, even though it is in such a macabre sort of setting, it is extremely touching to see the playful side of them coming through. One of the other things that I noticed was, and watch his body language every now and again, he does get slightly alert and look off in the distance, and that's because although we can't see her at the moment, very sadly, the Nyala's mother is still around. I haven't seen her for a little while, but she was hanging around waiting to see if her baby might come out somehow unscathed. Unfortunately, that is not a possibility, and Hosanna has dispatched it relatively quickly. Paul, you say, did Sindile learn faster than Hosanna, and was it perhaps because he was left alone as often as he was by Shadow at a young age? And just to provide some background for our newer viewers, Sindile is Karula's grandson. Oh, see? Temper, temper. She's not even anywhere near you. Cheeky boy. Sindile is the son of Shadow, Karula's daughter, one of Karula's oldest daughters, and we had a very interesting experience with him last year where at roughly 10 or so, 11 months old, he was being left alone more and more, far more often than is normal by Shadow as she went off to go and mate with Tingana. And as a result, we did see him often hunting and stalking by himself. Of course, that culminating in a really, truly unfortunate situation where he encountered and happened upon a feral dog that had wandered into the Sabi sand and that he ultimately caught. Paul, I'm not sure that he learned faster. I mean, he didn't manage to kill that dog. He was not successful with that at all. He did actually, when he had it, he appeared not quite to know what to do with it. Now, I'm not sure the two situations are comparable, but I suppose in a way there is a logic to wondering if perhaps he learned to hunt faster just because he had to. There is also logic to the idea that because Karula spends more time with her cubs, more time than Shadow did, not Shadow's fault, as we've spoken about before, it might have been a hormone imbalance, but it provides her cubs with opportunities like this where they can practice in what is almost a controlled environment. If Hosanna had gone, or Sindile had gone after a young Inyala like this, there's a very good chance they would have, if they were on their own, messed it up and the Inyala would have got away. But with under the watchful eye of Karula, her cubs can actually learn. It's like being taught to write and to read in a way that is more constructive than perhaps just throwing a book at a child and saying, well, there you go, now read. You can sort of understand which child might be more successful, the one that's actually been physically taught the techniques and the alphabet and so on. I think that's maybe the best way of trying to view it. Are you going to eat this poor baby in Yala, mister, or are you just going to play with it? Fortunately, this young Inyala knows nothing of this. And, as I said, this is essential. He's also learning what bite pressure to exert, how to do it, where to do it. And there we go. Now he's going to sort of properly start chewing. And while we sit with the royal family and watch them go about... Oh, that was cute, in a very macabre way. While we watch them going about their breakfast, the rain has brought out all kinds of creepy crawlies, and Steph has found a rather slimy one.
It is slimy. Have a look at this alien that we're busy showing you at the moment. It is, of course, a giant land snail, and we are at eye level, so to say, with him. Or her, or it, it's actually a both, a they, and just have a look at how absolutely bizarre that is. I'm told that you can see from your perspective, your side, a tiny little worm or something on its face. It's quite possible that this giant land snail has a parasite on it of some sort. It's absolutely feasible. They are enormous and would be far too good a food source to not have something like that on it. They do have four eyes, each on a stalk. So the two bottom eyes are looking underneath itself at the moment, and the two longer eyes are looking for movement or any threats from above. Imagine being able to see out of four eyes. What type of picture you'd be able to get, especially with that field of reference. Now watching me with one eye and watching you with the other. See if I can see that worm on its face now that it's facing me. To me, it looks like just its eye stalk. So not a parasite, just four eyes. Two at the top on long stalks, two at the bottom. And just giving it a full-on 360-degree view of its world. Stretched out now, probably at about maximum length. So if you had to stretch your hand open as wide as what you can, it's as long as the distance between your thumb point and the end of your baby finger. So that's how big they get. Just look at that. Let's see, he's on his way to the next plant. He's just devoured a plant. I'm waiting to see if he goes into a similar area. There's a similar plant he's heading towards, or they are heading towards, I should say. This is the largest land-based mollusk on the planet that you're having a look at, and a pristine example of one that is full grown. They don't get much bigger than this. Whoops, plant gave him a fright. James, you've asked me a very good question. One that I actually haven't found the answer to. I'm going to throw right back at you if you don't mind. James, you've asked, how long does it take a giant land snail to reach maturity? James, I've never found that fact, to be quite honest. But if any of you are out there and wanting to participate in helping us all learn a little bit more, please help us and I'll see what, you know, I'll share the information. The question is, the life cycle of the giant land snail, how long does it take to reach full size and full maturity? And I suppose a nice question on the back of that would be, what is their longevity? How old do they get? I'm not sure of those two questions, the answers to those two questions. You can of course send it through to the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or use the email questions@wildearth.tv and I'll share it with you as soon as they come through. I'm wondering if those eyes don't have a, not only are they sight, but they also seem to have a sensory function as well. Quite often you'll see them using their eyes to touch something, their eye stalks. You can see he's now exploring that cavity with his mouth parts, or with those mouth parts. Just one of the most bizarre creatures. His eyes look like octopus tentacles, is a comment I'm getting. And I must agree with you. I mean, imagine having your eyes on the end of slimy stalks like that, that you can attract into your head and then extend far out. It'd be like having a swimming pool net with an eyeball on the end. Oh, that is just so epic. Fuzzman Sparkles, you've just asked me if the giant land snail is the largest mollusk that you find on Juma, what is the second largest mollusk? Fuzzman Sparkles, I would have to say that it's an exotic snail that we identified last year as being a single-banded snail. I haven't found any this year yet. I expect that I will. And over the course of this drought, I've found many, many, many shells of these single-banded snails. They're a pest that has been transported around the globe, basically, from Europe in plants. And yes, they've even found their way into the Sabi Sands, and I've never found them in the Kruger Park, but I have found them in the Sabi Sands. I'm hoping that the drought has had a negative effect on their population numbers, but I would have to say that the second largest snail here is that. Actually, no, I'm wrong. The second largest mollusk in the Sabi Sands is the freshwater mussel. Is that a mollusk? Is a mussel a mollusk?
Yeah.
Yes, mussel's a mollusk. That gets to about just smaller than that, but it's aquatic, so it's not land-based. So that's the second largest, actually. But we're talking about in-water and out-water now as well. Right, and on that fantastic note, with the alien now departing our frame of view, we're going to say goodbye for now, of course. We will catch up with you in a little bit, and we're going to send you over to Brent.
As you can see, the Inkahumas are napping away still, and there's literally not an iota of movement from any of them. Those two look very cozy. And so, out of the... Oh, listen, lions. We heard another male lion roaring a little earlier. Sounded like it was behind us somewhere. And I think while the pride snoozes away, I think we might go look for the male lion who's on the move. Maybe he's heading back here. Maybe we'll be lucky enough to see another interaction between two male lions. That was absolutely fantastic last night. Those sounds were incredible. There you go, there's this big pause. About the size of a side plate. Definitely don't want to be on the receiving end of one of those slaps. Okay, so Aubrey's coming in here. There's only really space for one car where they're sitting at the moment, so I'm going to make space for him. I'm going to see if we can find that male that was roaring about 5 minutes ago. Remember, hashtag Safari Live if you've got any questions. And if you don't believe that we're live in the African bush, why don't you test that hashtag on Safari Live? Okay, so while we go to try find another male lion, let's go to a male leopard with Jamie.
A male leopard that has finally, perhaps upon instruction from Mom, although we'll never know, has finally stopped playing with his food and is finally feeding on it. He's eaten a little bit of the face, actually taken the easy way out. He hasn't managed to open up the carcass, so he's nibbling away on the ears and the nose. And it's been fascinating watching these cubs grow and to learn and to see how much of their behavior they have sort of developed almost instinctively or straight away instinctively, whether it's climbing up trees, and we saw it from a very, very early age, jumping up and down around the branches and ultimately learning, although they probably never realized it, ultimately learning the techniques that they were going to need to keep them safe and building up the muscle strength and coordination. Are you going that way? Okay, perfect. Thank you. Sorry, everybody. Just chatting to Rexon, who's responsible for providing us with the sighting and who finds himself in quite a tricky spot. And then from that, watching them sort of learn and grow to moments like this now where they're practicing their hunting techniques, and to see what instincts they have, and sometimes occasionally poorly executed, but they obviously know what to do, just not necessarily how to do it. And it does make you wonder about what sort of factors have led to the different personalities of the leopards that we've seen, or that you have seen, some of you for many, many years, grow up. Why is it that Tundi, who is the same age, from the same litter, with the same background as Shadow, is far better at hoisting her kills than Shadow is? What is it? Is it a weakness in Shadow? Perhaps her jaw is not as strong, perhaps her shoulders are not as strong, maybe she even injured her neck as a cub. We'll never really know. But what is it that creates that difference between different individuals? It'd be fascinating to find out. What we do know is that we see this common link in behaviors of the different leopard cubs in how they go about things. We've seen Shongile play with Dacres before, and now we've seen Hosanna do it with an Inyala. Hello, Your Majesty. Relaxed and quite content to let her leopard cub do his learning all on his own. Now, what's that style of teaching that sort of lets kids explore? Is the Montessori method, the way that they approach things. And I think that Karula's adopted that technique with her kids. And she makes sure that she directs them and steers them in the right direction and provides for them in the way that they needed to be provided for. But other than that, she lets them get on with things. The standard female leopard approach. She doesn't really have a choice, though. From the very beginning, she had to leave them and just hope that they were still there when she got back. And what a feeling that must be for a leopard. Every single time she went back to search for them. Annie, you say, since Hosanna did, of course, the dirty deed, so to speak, in killing the Inyala, you were wondering if perhaps he will feel that the kill is his and not want to share. Possibly. He might not want to share, but I don't think that's necessarily just a product of the fact that he kills it and therefore he feels like it is his. I think that he will not want to share because it's in his nature to not want to share. As leopards slowly grow older, they become more and more solitary in nature, and they are very, very possessive over their food. We saw Shadow's cub snarl at her mom when she was only a couple of months old, not too long ago, when she had that monkey kill. And we've seen lots of leopard cubs do it to each other. And for the most part, it's settled relatively amicably. Like all animals, they'd prefer to avoid a proper physical confrontation, which is why you do get recorded cases of leopards sharing. Although sharing kills is always a bit of a misnomer, because when a male leopard is involved, there's not much going on there's very seldom much going on in the way of sharing. He's largely doing the eating, and the females or the cubs are nibbling around at the sort of other end of the carcass. Morning, Mike. How are you? No, you're perfect. Don't worry. Don't stress. Shame. Mike just worried that he was blocking our shot in some way. What was I saying? Oh, yes. I'm talking about him being possessive. I think he's just going to be possessive for the sake of being possessive. Of course, moments like this with these cubs is always a little bittersweet, because we know one day that they are going to grow up and move off, and we might not, particularly in the case of Hosanna, we might, once he disperses, we might not ever see him again. We might hear word of him from other lodges, but he could move very, very far away. Though, of course, we're all hoping he doesn't. We've still got some time left. And Roger, that's in answer to your question, which is what happens when leopard cubs grow up? Do they go off in search of their own territories? It's an interesting difference, and we're already seeing it between Hosanna and Shongile. Hosanna is a male cub, and even though he's exactly the same age as his sister, he's about half her body size bigger than she is. A really solid difference between a male and a female, and even at this age. And it'll play out in terms of their behavior as well. Shongile will probably become independent sooner than Hosanna. She'll move away from her mother sooner, but she'll stay in the area. And essentially, female leopards, their offspring often take up neighboring territories, and often the female leopard's territory shrinks as she gets older and the more female offspring she has. That was very graceful, mister. Very controlled. Yeah, well, you can't take it that way, can you? Because then you might have to share it. So now what are you going to do? Ah, that looks very comfortable. Sorry, Roger. So yes, a female will carve out bits of her own territories for her daughters, although it's a more gradual process and it's not as simple as the way that I've expressed it. It's not so much she gives it to them as it's sort of, they just sort of inherit it. Male cubs, on the other hand, when they do become independent, they take a little bit longer and they often hang around their natal area, in other words, where they were born, for quite a long time. But when they do get to the age of about 3 or 4, they start to properly disperse. And leopard cubs, or male leopards, have been recorded as dispersing as far as 500, 600 kilometers, maybe even more. Just in terms of looking, it just depends on where there is a territorial vacuum, where they feel they can be safe until they're big enough and strong enough to fight for a territory. It is so fascinating, and we've been very lucky to watch that play out with Karula's previous offspring. Her two sons, Shambambalana, who is 6 years old, and her son Quarantine, who is 4, so a litter apart, are competing at the moment for essentially the same territory. And every now and again, Quarantine and Shambambalana do actually come into conflict with each other. So it's fascinating. And the funny thing about animals, and the amazing thing about animals, is that they don't read the textbooks, so they're completely unpredictable. But they do have a general standard of behavior. And there we go. That brings us very smoothly into Paul's question about the fact that Hosanna was first at the... Oh, that was such a gorgeous face again. He really is a beautiful leopard. Paul, you wanted to know whether or not the males are more assertive than the females naturally, since he was the first one at the kill. Not necessarily. That's where there is a personality drive. Male leopards are bigger and more dominant than the females, and you'll see that relatively early on in their behavior. However, we have seen Shungile get to kills first and play with them and hiss at her brother and be able to hold her own, so to speak. So whilst there is a massive size difference, and testosterone for the most part in mammals leads to a total dominance in terms of the different, the only exception being the spotted hyena, it's interesting to watch the different personalities of females. And Shungile is more than capable of holding her own against her brother. And it's all about the ferocity of the attack. That if she wanted to, I think she could have been equally involved, although there might have been a scrap between them. But somehow they just know, and they slot together and they take turns, and each one, it's the next one's turn at some point. Just whoever happens to be closest to the kill itself. I think it's personality-driven, personally, Paul. And I personally find Shungile quite spirited, having watched her behave in exactly the same way as Hosanna. But as they get older, that dominance will become more and more clear. Just because he's going to be so much bigger than she is. He's already almost the size of Karula. Not in terms of weight, but certainly in terms of height. He has contorted himself into all manner of uncomfortable-looking positions. Wrapped over the fallen tree. He's just had the most fantastic morning. And as a result, so have we. We've also been able to enjoy this incredible time spent with them. I'm not planning on going anywhere. We have the pleasure of being able to spend probably most of the morning with the royal family, which is exactly what we're going to do. In the meantime, let's head across to Brent so we can find out what his plans are for the rest of the morning.
Well, Welcome back. We're now right down in the east of the reserve. We went and had a quick look for that male lion, and then Jandre and I had a chat, and we decided, what do we want to see? And I'm going to go look for an animal that makes all of us very happy. So we're going to try find some elephants. They are really spread out at the moment, but fingers crossed we're going to have some luck. And there are some tracks around here heading towards the northwest, so I'm going to do a big loop, and hopefully... Oh, excuse me. I swallowed a bug. It's the second one today. Can you believe it? Okay. Extra protein, early breakfast and all that. I'm hoping as we head along our northern edge of Traverse area, we're going to find some elephants. I heard there were some big Eddie bulls around, so hopefully they're still about. And remember, hashtag Safari Live for questions. You're on a live African drive here from the Greater Kruger National Park in South Africa. And isn't it incredible that we are coming to you live from the middle of the bush? Oh, what's that? There's the big bird in the tree. I think it could be a vulture, but let's get a bit closer before we make any judgment calls. Ah, it is a vulture. It looks like to be a white-backed vulture. Or is it a white-backed vulture? The head shape definitely looked like a vulture. It is a white-backed vulture. Now, only one vulture here. Unlikely that there's a carcass around. Probably just rested in that tree for the evening. Look how even that vulture's a bit... Is that crop full? Yes. Full vulture. You can see that massive, powerful beak. Now, that gives you an idea how tough a lot of the bigger animals' skin is, like buffalo or hippo, that even a white-backed vulture with that incredibly strong beak is unable to tear through the skin. It needs a predator to open up the carcass for it. Now, a vulture is going to be hoping for some sunnier, warmer weather. Now, they generally like the thermals to get going, so this cool weather means there's not too much warm air rising off the ground, so it makes moving around for them quite difficult. Being such a heavy bird, they generally will expend quite a lot of energy flying until they can find those thermals, the warm air rising, and then they'll use those, lock in their wings, and just soar without expending any energy. So vultures can become a little bit hungry during the cold weather. I've seen another animal up ahead. Let's go have a look. Oh, spider web on my aerial. Now, I've seen one of our smaller residents of a Juma Private Game Reserve. Now, it is an absolutely glorious little antelope. And I'm going to get us a bit closer to it. Hopefully, they don't dash away. Sometimes the little antelope, being little, can be quite nervous and worried about everything eating them. Where'd he go? He's standing right around this termite mound. Dashed off already. Oh, Jandre's got a visual. Had a visual. That's what I said. Oh, there we go. Okay, I know. I see it now. Let's go a bit further forward. Now, these little antelope live in pairs, and they are monogamous. One of the few antelope species that is. And I think that is, let me just have a look, see if I'm just getting past the little bushes there. A little bit further. Here we go. That is the little male Steenbok. You can see his little horns. Now, they live in a small area of about 4 acres. Oh, dashing, dashing, dashing. Now, because they live in such a small area, sometimes it can make it a little bit easier for predators to find them. So they've got some interesting defense mechanisms to avoid the teeth and claws of the various predators out here. One is that they actually bury their feces. So, of course, they spend so much time in a small area that they have to dig down, bury their feces to help not be seen by, or not be seen, but smelt and by a lot of the predators. And their second defense mechanism is actually how they got their name. A steen is a brick in Afrikaans, and so it's a brickbuck, and it's called a brickbuck because one of their most successful ways to avoid predators is to keep stock still. So they'll just lie there, and I've actually seen wild dogs sniff within 30 centimeters of a steenbok that's just basically closed its eyes and going, I hope this works, and it does work quite well. So anyway, that's two really interesting defensive mechanisms that a little antelope like a steenbok can use to avoid the big predators. Good morning, Cola. Nice to hear from you again. Cola would like to know, is that behavior from herd behavior, or is it from when they're born? Well, I think most of it's instinctive, and steenboks don't live in herds. They live in pairs, so there's only two of them ever together. Unless there's a baby, then you'll sometimes see three, but normally you'll only see two in a territory, and quite often even then one could be on this side of the territory, one can be on the other. And like with a lot of animals, I'd say that behavior is instinctive, so if they're born with that knowledge, it's many, many thousands of years of evolution kicking in. No elephant tracks crossing yet, which is a good sign, which means they could still be on Juma. And I'm really hoping we find some ellies. A nice big bull would be wonderful. And there's that spider web that's just really... There we go, driving me nuts, I got it. And it had just a little bit of leaf attached to it, so it just kept jumping into my eye line. Oh, this is a good morning for tortoises, nice and cool and still damp, so we might find the odd speaks hinged tortoise or leopard tortoise on the march. That would be quite pleasant. Okay, we're gonna keep checking for elephants here up on the northern edge of Juma while we do that. And let's go see how Steph's faring on foot.
We're busy approaching the scene of a crime, a kill scene. Here you can see a low-felt gardenia that's been hammered by an elephant. And this year, in particular, in response to the drought, the elephants were targeting the gardenias. And what's quite interesting about why they've been targeting these gardenias lies in the fact that the elephant don't eat, or don't seem to eat, anything to do with the branches. Come and have a look here. They're really just targeting the roots. So you can see this is the low-felt gardenia. This is a tree probably hundreds of years old. They grow incredibly slowly, a few millimeters, a few centimeters a year only. But none of the branches were touched. Only the roots. And you can almost see how they pared the tree down. Right where I'm standing is where the tree was growing, and you can see how the bush has just been strewn with branches. The elephants were targeting the roots, just the roots. And the reason for that is that these roots, in humans at least anyway, are used as a purgative. It induces vomiting, it also induces a runny tummy. And the traditional uses for this tree are exactly that, as a cleansing agent, as a body cleansing agent. And, oh, it's a bittery smell, leaves are quite a weird, like you smell it to the back of your tongue almost. Ooh, not very nice. Give it to Brian to have a smell there. Weird smell. So anyway, back to the point, is that the elephants right at the end of the dry season, right at the end of the drought, were targeting this. It's not for food. My belief at least is anyway, it's a type of self-medication. The elephants this year were forced to eat a lot of woody compounds, a lot of roots. And the trees out here, some of them are quite violently toxic. And I think that the elephants use roots like this to purge their systems of these toxins so that they can carry on eating. The little bit of nutrients that they do get from their roots needs to be balanced against their systems being poisoned slowly over the dry season. I absolutely believe that these elephants know, or the older elephants at least anyway, know that at the end of a dry season, when your body has got these accumulated toxins, to have a bit of a purgative every now and again is a good thing. And I think that is why these gardenias were targeted this year, is that the elephants just sort of self-medicating. Don't you just think that that's a fantastic story? I mean, they haven't dug out the roots. They've just pushed the tree over, and the root bark and the roots that have come up with the tree have been eaten. Tree has been destroyed. I mean, this is really the only root that's left, and the few smaller roots around my legs, there's a smaller root, chewed. Just, I don't know, incredible. I suppose similar to how people around the world, I know in particular, the African people in South Africa value seawater as a purgative. So quite often around Christmas time is the time where people traditionally celebrate this particular ritual of drinking a lot of seawater, bathing in the seawater, purging their bodies, and cleansing themselves of toxins and of, I suppose, bad spirits in a way. I think this do the same. You know, we don't gift elephant enough intelligence, I think. I think they know exactly what they're doing. Exactly. Even if just on a purely instinctual level. We're still on our way to Sydney's. It's just been such a lovely day for a walk. You can see we've got this quite thick band of clouds, which is keeping it cool. I would say that it's probably in the upper 60s at the moment, maybe low 70s. No sun to speak of, just an unbelievably, no wind to speak of as well. Just creating the circumstances for a very, very nice walking day. We're still on our way to Sydney, so when we get there, we'll give you another update. In the meantime, you're going to go and have a look at a giraffe.
Look at this. We've got two young boys, young male giraffe. So we didn't find the elephants, but we found the second largest mammal out here. And they are play fighting. Not very serious, but it is quite graceful. It's almost like a ballet dance. And of course, these guys are way too young to be competing for mating rights yet. So this is just practice sparring. You can see how they widen their stance to get a bit of stability before they swing their neck. And it's very much a blocking and parrying, and there we go. The one closest to us is a bit older. It's the feint when you're going to swing. Try to catch your opponent unawares. Ballet / boxing. It's quite a strange movement. And it's interesting how you wouldn't think that that neck was so flexible, and you can see how they bend and twist. Now this is only playing. Look at that. Now, I can't see if there's any other giraffe around. It's possible. It's quite likely sometimes with young males. So it sounds like you guys are getting some incredible screen shots or screen grabs of this wonderful giraffe ballet / boxing match. Nina's is wondering, how do I know which of the giraffes older? Is it by their height or by their colouring? Colouring's a bit of a dangerous one. It's just based on body size and height. So the one at the back is significantly bigger than the one closest to us at the moment. So you can just see the thickness of the neck, the height, all of that comes into telling how old they are. Well, I don't know how old they are, but they're probably under, maybe around 10, under 10, the smaller one. Now, giraffes are quite long-lived. They live to about 30 years old in the wild. Well, looks like time to go snack. No? Now, this is very, very much quite tame, quite mild, just playing, as I was saying. And Anna-Marie's wondering, have I ever seen a serious giraffe fight in person? Anna-Marie, I've seen quite a few. And you can actually hear the fight going on from up to 2 kilometers away as those males smack into each other with incredible force. I'm going to try to get a little bit closer. Now, a lot of people initially thought that the giraffe's long neck was for food competition. That's why it evolved. And the more research that's been done into it, it turns out it's actually seems to be more for sexual competition. So the fighting over females, the males with the longest neck gets to swing the hardest. So obviously using it as a great big pendulum. Hello, boys. Looks like you guys have been at it for a while, judging by the tracks in the road. And you can see that. Now, hi, Emily. Emily Moore is wondering, will giraffes still play fight when they're fully matured? Not that I've ever seen. When big adult males start fighting, it's generally quite serious. And it will be because there's a female and he's just close by. Boys. Where are the elephants? You're tall, you can see them. So point us in the right direction, giraffe. That's why. I was wondering, why are they running off? There's a large construction lorry coming down the road behind us, so I'm going to get out of the way. Oh, maybe we'll stay for a quick last look. Hello, boys. There's a lot of vultures around here now. I saw some to the south, now there's some to the north. You can see the vulture in the tree beyond the giraffe there. We're going to move on before we keep causing traffic jams. So while we keep moving on, let's go back to Jamie and the leopards. Glulamit.
After the exertions of his morning, Hosanna is taking a little bit of a break. He has beheaded the Inyala carcass and dumped it behind that fallen log and is now resting, quite exhausted after his endeavours of the morning. Are you tired, little boy? Has it been a very busy day already, and it's not even 7 o'clock yet? As he snoozes away, he's now put himself in a rather inconvenient position, and we might have to do some repositioning, because I can't see Gorilla at all. No, that's not true. I can. That's as much as I can see of Gorilla. And my view of Shungile is not fantastic either. Oh no, it's not so bad. Not a terrible view of Shungile, but it is not perhaps her prettiest end, and she is a very, very pretty leopard. All in all, three very sleepy and contented ladies. Two ladies and one boy. Let me just do some repositioning so that we've got a slightly better view of Hosanna. As I said, he's chewed the head off. I'm not entirely sure where it has disappeared to, but I had a sort of impression in my mind, or a vivid image of it rolling down into the Mwati drainage line. I doubt that has actually happened, though. I think he probably would have gone to fetch it. Yeah. Let's see. Oh, drat. I think I missed the gap. Let's see if we do this. That'll do. I don't want to get too much closer. I think it will upset Gorilla a little bit. Heads up. Hello, girl. As I said, I don't want to push any further into their space. And they're quite contented in their thicket of gwari bushes. Now, the nice thing would be for the spot in terms of having breakfast is that Karula would already have assessed the area and decided which tree she would put the kill into. But for now, she's not even going to bother. There is so little of it. It was such a tiny little Nyala that I don't think she's going to bother to do it. I think the three of them are going to finish it off. I mentioned earlier that they had already eaten. They did actually have a baby Inyala kill yesterday. And Amber, you wanted to know how long Hosanna will stay full from eating this baby Inyala. Well, one question, of course, is whether or not he's going to scoff at all, or if he's going to allow his mother and sister to feed off some of it. But even then, the metabolisms of these predators work so incredibly fast that, and especially because he is a growing boy, so his body's putting all of that nutrients into expanding his size, I think you'll probably find that he'll go from round-bellied to almost flat-bellied in about 24 to 30 hours. It doesn't last them very long at all, which is why the pressure is sort of on Karula to be able to provide for them almost constantly. What are you looking at? Oh, looking at Mom. Oh, Gorilla, I wish you were on the other side of the log. That would have been such a fun role to have watched. Just a flash of white belly and feet up in the air. And he's still watching every single move that they make, whether it's Shungile or Gorilla. Because basically his thinking at the moment is, I'm tired and I want to rest. And I'm actually quite full, so I don't really want to eat anything, but actually nobody else can have any either. Almost like a spoiled child that doesn't want to share. It's not his fault, though. It's not because he's spoiled. He's just a leopard doing what leopards do naturally. And moments like this are incredibly peaceful. It also makes one sort of want to go and join them. You can just enjoy the beauty of a morning like this morning. No sleepy. I know that the other day Brent had the opportunity to look at both Hosanna and Shungile's whisker spots. Whisker spots, which is of course the way in which we identify various leopards. And I have a question to ask of all of you. as to what the conclusion was about the spot patterns of the two of them, because I heard something about Shungile having 5, which is very, very unusual. I haven't actually truly taken in the leopard spots of the spot patterns of these two cubs. For our new viewers, essentially one of the ways of identifying leopards is to look at the top row of whisker spots, which of course, as I started speaking about, he then hid relatively effectively behind a branch, positioning himself most comfortably. But if you wouldn't mind sending through the information on the spot patterns, I would be tremendously grateful. And speaking of spotted patterns, of course, leopards are not the only one to utilize such things. Unless I have misunderstood, Rebecca, I think it sounds as though Steph has found a spotted insect.
We managed to find another one of these jewel beetles that we saw yesterday in the tent. And very kindly identified as a Buprestid, which is the genus. All jewel beetles are Buprestid, or from the Buprestidae. And then an unpronounceable scientific name. I just have to say thank you for that, but I, for the life of me, cannot remember what it is. I needed to write it down at the time. But definitely jewel beetle, and definitely one of the more colorful of any of the beetles that we find out here. Just have a look at that. Coppery colored head, all those stripes, weird dotted pattern at the end. Tiny, tiny little guy. Yeah. But that's not why we wanted to stop here. Why I wanted to stop here, I'm not one given to quizzes and things. I'd rather just tell you what it is. But in this particular case, I think what we're going to do is open up a quiz for you on what this track is. So a bit of track and sign identification. I'm going to put my Leatherman down here as a key to size. And I would like you to tell me what the track is that is inside there. This track. All right, I'm going to give you some keys as to it, because otherwise it will be unfair. This is one track, and this is one track. So two tracks next to each other, and individual digits with a larger digit on the one side. So similarly repeated this side. Large digit, individual digits on this side. Not a common track to see. Let's see who of you can get it. Right, that is my quiz for today. Let's see what it's gonna be. So just the last little bit there, give you some screenshot time. Leatherman in there for a bit of scale. If you want to know a finger width, there's my finger for a bit of scale. Let's see if you can guess. Alrighty, we are almost at Sydney's Dam. I can hear the Egyptian geese honking in the distance. So, WLE, you've asked me, or you've submitted your answer in response to that. You've said, is it a porcupine? WLE, no, it's not a porcupine. It is a bit too small to be a porcupine. And remember, I said that there were 2 feet next to one another. So if we put 2 porcupine feet next to one another, we would have ended up with a track about that big. 2 of them. Porcupine feet are about that big in size. So a little bit too big. Good guess. Carry on. You're on the right path here. So let's say why you're on the right path. You got the digits. You got the digits right. Melinden James, you've submitted dwarf mongoose. Right size, wrong animal, and it's wrong because a dwarf mongoose has 4 pads of equal size, equal dimensions. This has Well, let me see if I can give you, this is going to give it away. This has a different amount of pads. Let me rather do that. So a different amount of pads to a dwarf mongoose, but the same size. You're on the right track there. Anything more? Lindsay, you've asked, is it a baboon? Closer than you think, Lindsay, but it's not a baboon. I quite like this, to be quite honest. I've never been one for quizzes, but I'm quite enjoying myself with this one. Don't worry, I won't steal Brent's thunder, though. He is the quiz maestro. Oh, we're approaching this hippo lawns that is around Sydney's. Nectarneg, you've got it. 10 out of 10. It is a bush baby. That is exactly the track that you saw there, is of the lesser bush baby. Well done, Nectarneg. That is actually a very, very good submission over there. That you definitely got it much quicker than I thought anyone would get it. I think it took me longer to decide what it is. All right, we're going to send you back over to Jamie.
As often happens with a baby antelope kill, or perhaps a baby buffalo kill, we then have the very sad situation where poor mom has come back in search of her little one. And this female Nyala is slowly but surely putting herself in more and more danger the closer she looks for her baby. She knows she last saw her baby here. I don't know if she's realized that the leopards are still here, or what exactly has happened. All she knows is that instinct is driving her into where she knows there's danger, just to see whether or not she can try and help her little one or find it. And moments like this are absolutely heart-wrenching. I'm sorry, girl. I'm sorry. It's all over. And there'll be more to come. You can see she's intent and alert. She's looking across at the leopards. I think she's seen Shongile, but I'm not too sure. Now, leopards are incredibly opportunistic creatures. I don't think Kurula's realized just how close this female is, because I think her body language would be very different if she had. But if she does realize this female in Yala's here, it wouldn't be the first time that a female has stumbled in to try and save a baby and ended up becoming a meal herself. Excuse me. She's very, very jumpy. She knows that leopards were around. She just doesn't know exactly where they are. Don't do it, girl. Don't come any closer. Ears out and alert, nose constantly sniffing. I think she's actually tried to circle round in a way that she can approach with slightly more vegetation cover, but also with a bit more visibility so that she can actually see. So she's moved out of the riverbed and onto the top of the bank. Don't come this way. She can see she's moving along the outskirts, making sure she's got a nice open path to flee through. She's getting closer and closer to us. And drawn by that instinct to go and look for her little one. Every step closer she takes, it becomes more and more dangerous. At the distance she's at now, she's probably about, I would say about 30 meters away from Kurula. It's still too far. Kurula will not be able to cover that distance fast enough. You know, if Kurula was awake, of course, which she is not. But every time the Inyala closes that gap, she gets herself further and further into trouble. And she knows it. She knows it's dangerous. Imagine what this is like for her. Every instinct is telling her to run. There was a leopard there was a predator there. It's not safe. And yet she's got that incredibly strong maternal bond driving her on against her fear. Unbelievable display of bravery. One thing that she has done, which I selfishly am quite glad for, is she hasn't called. And Margaret, you were wondering if she might call for her baby. No, I don't think she's going to, although it does happen. We've seen it with buffalo, zebra. Often the female animal will call to see if she can't relocate her little one. But for the most part, Nyala female relatively quiet. It's more the babies that bleat and make quite a bit of noise. But Margaret, I don't think she's going to. I think she's aware of how much danger there is. Shame, girl. Almost wish we could communicate to her that it's done. There's no point. You can see the... Oh, goodness. Flies crawling all over next to her eyes. She's not even blinking. She's so scared. It's okay, girl. We're not a threat. And still, the Queen of Juma sleeps on. Can't see any sign of movement. A meter closer, 2 meters closer. Step by step by step. Now, Steph, you were wondering if she looks like a first-time mum. Since she doesn't look very old. I was thinking the same thing, Steph. She doesn't. She looks very young. So yes, it could well be her first baby. And likely, although it's a very sad thought, it's probably not going to be the first one she loses either, or the only one that she loses. Oh, Shungila, I think, has given away her position. She just rolled over. And it's done. Shungila rolled over, and the Nyala female spotted her. We've got such a tug-of-war happening in this Nyala's mind. Fear and instinct. Look at the indecision in her body language. Whilst she stays frozen in position and decides what to do, I think that Steph has made his way all the way to one of the largest water holes. Let's go across to him.
Yeah, the largest empty water hole. We are at Sydney's now. It's a fairly common sight for you to see Sydney's dam, to be honest. I haven't seen Sydney's dam in probably more than 2 months. 2 months, I think. The last time I was in a vehicle was the last time I saw Sydney's dam, and that was an age ago, it feels like. I can't actually remember when last I was in a vehicle. And I'm dumbstruck at how empty it actually is. I mean, we've had some rain, so it has filled up a little bit, but generally speaking, is much emptier than I thought it would be. I mean, it was obviously the drought, and obviously we haven't had a lot of rain, but it's jarring every now and again when you see something that you don't expect, I think is the real answer. What have we seen while we've been here? Not much, really. There was some waterbuck and some impala on the way in here that we saw. There's a squirrel busy giving an alarm call for something around here. No fresh tracks of much except for a buffalo or two. But that's it. We're going to start making our way back now to camp. Another hour and a half or so walking back to camp. But lots of stuff still on the way. We're going to send you over to Jamie for that Mummy Nyala.
And listen to this. The standoff is over. She knew there was something, but she didn't realize what it was. And now she's barking out her alarm call. And it was, in the end, it was Shungile that broke the standoff. She couldn't stand. Just sorry, let me let you hear the sound of this bark. See if she does it. Now she knows, ultimately, exactly what happened to her little one. She knows she can keep a safe distance. She knows where the leopards are, although I don't think she knows where Karula is. I think she knows where the cubs are, but I don't think she's realized that Karula's there. And that deep, powerful alarm call. And as I said, ultimately it was Shungile that broke the standoff. She couldn't stand the thought that her brother might have more breakfast than she does. And she got up and she moved. And as she did, Hosanna got up to defend the girl. And our female Inyala realized exactly what it was she was looking at. And why all of her instincts were saying run. But still she stays. Such a characteristic sound. Sound that when you hear it, you know automatically it means there's a lion or a leopard nearby. Nyala and Kudu don't do false alarms very often. Sorry, my girl. It's time to walk away. She knows she's at a safe distance. She knows, and in fact, she'd rather keep an eye on where the leopards are, moving slowly rather than running, so that she can make sure that they're not going to come bursting out after her. Little Shungile? Well, you've ruined the chance of a buffet, my girl. But at least you've managed to get the head. I love that sound, I have to say. It's a beautiful sound. A deep booming bark. Little Shungile, clutching her prize, trying to work out whether in fact it was worth it after all of that. Although it does make quite a fun toy. And as our leopard cubs devour what's left of the baby Inyala, off goes Mom. She's given up. And survival instinct has won. Ooh, shame, she's so jumpy. And off she goes to start the whole process again. Girl. If she's made it, let's see what Shungile is up to. Here she goes, clutching at the head, which has now managed to get jammed between the various branches. Nicholas, you want to know why she left the baby in the first place? Because she was scared. And because leopards came bursting out of nowhere and she didn't know what was happening and panic took hold and she ran. In the vague, because there was nothing she could have done. There was no way she could have defended her baby against three leopards. Sharp claws and teeth at the ready. And she just had to hope that her baby followed her. And when it didn't, she went back to see, to investigate where it was, in the vain hope that perhaps it was still alive. But there would not have been anything that she could have done. Buffalo fight back, sometimes zebra fight back. But Inyala just, especially female Inyala, just don't quite have that capacity. Oh dear, Shungile, what has happened here? Have you got it trapped? Now what are you going to do? Her son has disappeared into the Mawati with his kill. He's dragged it off down there. He wasn't going to let his sister have any of it, despite the fact that he was fast asleep when she went up to eat some. Oh, she is very beautiful. She'll have to return to one of her favorite pastimes of nudging and battering trees, playing with them instead. I think she's lost her head as well. There we go, girl. A big and somewhat, in my imagination, somewhat frustrated yawn. Second girl. Did it just fall into the most inconvenient place? And where's your brother gone? I think what we'll probably do is we'll probably sit here for another few moments and then go around to back down into the drainage line itself. To see whether or not we can't catch up with Hassana and see whether Shungile. Okay, whether we can't see her from the other side. Oh dear. That head is stuck between the Jackalberry on the right. Oh, sorry, not Jackalberry, Tambuerti. It's a Tambuerti. The large trunk that you see on the right of Shungile. And then the fallen, what I think is a fallen leadwood. And then there's a sort of a whole combination of raisin bushes growing in between them. And the head is stuck in there, and she just can't quite get it out, despite her best efforts. She's going to try, though. So much fun to watch them problem solve, and the frustrations along the way. And the little shake of the tail. And the distractions as well, in terms of their attention span. One minute she's trying to get the head, the next she's attacking a branch. Now she's going to go and investigate what her brother's doing. I have no doubt that on the other side of this slope, he is snarling at her. Luckily, she's not particularly starving. She already obviously had a share of Mom's kill. And in fact, she actually looks even more... You're right, Viam. You pointed that out this morning. She looks even more round-bellied than Hassana does. So it might even be that she got the most of the last kill. In which case, it's only fair that her brother enjoys a little bit more than she does. Looking up at a bird in the tree. Now looking at her tail. Constant short-term attention span. Okay. I'm trying to decide whether or not I'm going to be cutting off my nose to spite my face if I go down into the drainage line. Might not have a view of them at all. And perhaps we'll stick with Shungile a little bit longer. We haven't spent much time with her this morning, so it might be nice to. There's nothing quite like the atmosphere in the bush after the rain. The birds are all chirping away merrily. Everything feels crisp and clean. There's no dust floating around. And the place just feels like it's teeming with life. Like everywhere you look, there's something new and exciting to be found. I wonder if Shungile feels much the same way. All sorts of movements and sounds. Imagine how much she hears. She's seen something. It might even be that Nyala, actually. She might have moved around. But imagine what kind of a sensory overload Sama must be. They must have some way of tuning out the sounds around them. If their hearing is as sensitive as it is, we often feel as if we're a little bit overwhelmed by the cicadas and the various insects. Imagine what it must be like for them. Listening to the sound of the wood borers in the trees and the insects rustling in the grass, and somehow being able to filter all of that noise out, the sound of the birds, to what is only what is relevant in their lives. The alarm call, perhaps, or the rustle of bushes that is not just insects or the wind, but actually something moving through it. It's absolutely essential that they're able to distinguish between the different sounds. It is fascinating the way that they can do it, when you think how much more acute their senses are than ours. How much of their brain is devoted to identifying each and every single individual noise that they hear. Leopard family settles in for a relaxed Wednesday morning. Let's go and find out what Brent has been up to.
Well, we've continued on our elephant endeavor, but without any luck. Unfortunately, I'm very confident to say there's not an elephant on Juma this morning. I've done the whole northern boundary, most of the western boundary, and now I'm heading down towards the south. So, we've changed tack a little bit, and we're again checking every herd of impala to possibly be lucky enough to see the first born impala lamb of the year. So I'm heading down towards Zoe's Road, which is always a favorite spot for impala to hang about, and see if we get any luck there. Remember the hashtag Safari Live if you want to ask us any questions. And it is a stunning morning, nice and cool here in the African bush, and as Jamie's just mentioned, teeming with life after the rain. You can hear insects. I'm hoping to see some good birds, but we're just going to keep scouring the earth to see what we can find for you. We're coming down to the junction of Zoe's Road and Balanati's Road, and I'm hoping there's a herd of impala in that area, and maybe, fingers crossed, and I'll have a little bebe with them. No sign of this impala herd yet. They might be a little bit further to the south. Hi, Robin in San Diego. Beautiful part of the United States, San Diego. Now, Robin would like to know, do all kingfishers have different calls? Indeed they do. So of course the most common that we hear during the summer, but not yet, is the trill of a woodlands kingfisher. Ch-chirr, ch-chirr, ch-chirr. Now, although a lot of the kingfisher calls are quite similar, they are in fact different, Wait, let me just get to this lovely, one of my favorite spots on Juma. It's got a wonderful vista as we look down towards the southeast over the Mowati Basin. So Jamie's right in that river basin with Queen Karula and the progeny. And we are right on the top of one of the crests looking down. Oh, and we found a bird as well, but not the kingfisher. Don't run away. I'll pretend I'm not going towards you. Have you got him there, Jean-André? It's not a koran. It is a black-bellied bustard. To the right, there he is. Often called the champagne bird due to the call it does when it's trying to attract a mate. It goes and sounds like a champagne cork clicking. Now, Robin, I haven't forgot about your kingfishers, don't you worry. There we go. I'm just trying to get the calls out. There we go. It called. Did you hear that? Blip. I'm just going to go a little bit further back. Obviously, my whistling is not nearly as good as James Henry's, but I do attempt. Hopefully it calls again. It's going to wander out into the road now. Oh, found something to eat. Give us one more call, come on. Now that was dismal compared to how beautiful the black-bellied bustard does it. Come on, here we go. Oh, they descend their neck. Here we go. Yeah, so wonderful. Come on, again. So when they're calling like that, they are looking for to attract other black-bellied bustards. Sometimes it's a little while between calls. There we go, see the beaks open, it might be preparing. Oh, awesome. It is amazing all the different variations that the different creatures out here use to attract the ladies. And the same could be said for human beings. Not much prump and preen that the male goes through. There you go, doing a little bit of, you know, gelling of the feathers. Making sure, looking ship shape in case a lady wanders through. Got to make sure all those feathers are looking ship shape. If one's out of place, she might turn him down and go and look for another boy. There we go. That's absolutely wonderful. Now, that we get the red-crested koran here. They are related, even though this is quite a lot bigger. Well, one stoner and two cats says it almost sounds like water drops. It is. It does have a wonderful liquid chortle to it. Now, there's quite a few different animals that might prey upon a koran. Now, it's actually been found in leopard scat quite frequently, or black-bellied bustard, and also martial eagles have been known to take them quite commonly. Not always, but quite often, the black-bellied bastard male will display close to an old nest site, normally within about 200 meters of it. So there could be an old nest site somewhere here. Now, Aaron is wondering how big is the egg of a black-bellied bastard. It's about 5 to 6 centimeters in length, and it weighs between 70 and 80 grams. Now, their nest isn't a nest as such. It's very similar to the other ground nesting birds. It's a scrape in the ground. So knowing that, they often call close to nest sites. It's a very, very important for us to check very carefully if we see him with a girl. Maybe we'll find her. I've never found a busted nest on Safari Live, but there's a first time for everything. Still preening away. Elegantly marked feathers. I love those big tail feathers that stick up there. You can see wonderful stripes along them. Oh, some serious cleaning of the wings there. And you can see that black line that runs all the way from the belly up the neck. There we go. Lebec said, did I say black-bellied? Yes, I did. So it is a black-bellied bastard. We can't really see its belly from here, but there's that dark line that runs down from under the throat onto a full black belly. There we go. There's that dark line that goes down, and underneath those wings, there's a black stomach. Oh, we nearly got a view of it there. Let's get those feathers in order, mister. Here comes another call. See how it extends its neck. Jason says this is a lovely specimen of a bastard. I agree, and being very, very kind to us and displaying so nicely for us out in the open. Quite often you hear it, and it could be behind some bushes or in some thickets. Now, Robin, I haven't forgotten about the kingfishers, don't you worry. And we're going to leave this bastard to keep trying to attract a girlfriend. So, as I said, we haven't quite heard the chitter of a woodlands kingfisher yet. And hopefully we're going to be hearing it soon as they arrive. So Robin was wondering how the different kingfishers sound. So that's the woodlands. Now, grey-hooded kingfisher, Tristan, a friend of mine, saw one recently. So they could be around already. So they sound similar, but not quite the same. And then the two we hear the most, obviously, the most common in this area is, of course, the brown hooded and the striped. Now, they call throughout the year. Some of you might recognize this one. And the striped kingfisher. So those are two resident of the non... Very pretty call. Now, Those are the two sort of more permanently resident of the non-water-bound kingfishers. So the Hallison kingfishers, the ones that are mostly insectivorous and don't spend their time around permanent water. Not to say you don't see them, and also I've seen a couple of pygmy kingfishers so far, tiny little wonderful guys with pink cheeks, but we haven't managed to get them on camera. They're still quite quick. There used to be a pygmy kingfisher nest at one of the old hyena dens, and so hopefully we find that nest again, or maybe even see one today. So we're still in search of elephants and baby impala, and the only part of Juma I haven't checked this morning is the south, so that's where we're heading. Now, the other relative to the black-bellied bustard is the red-crested koran. Now, we haven't yet caught the red-crested koran's mating display on camera, and I think we'll all be very excited to whoever manages to catch that first. Now, that's obviously called the suicide bird, or it's a nickname, and what they do to impress the ladies is the males will fly after calling directly up into the air, close their wings and plummet to the ground and open just before. So the closer, the more daredevil you are, the better you are in the eyes of the female red-crested koran. Now back to the kingfishers. Paul's wondering, do the females also call like that? They do, Paul, so male and female kingfishers will call quite similarly. Actually, before, let's go back. I spotted something next to the vehicle. And there we go. So there we go. We're just looking at this. Oopsie. Little plant there. Now, it's a very distinct heart-shaped leaf, and I'm wondering if anyone remembers my lessons from before the drought and the dry season, and that is a really useful medicinal plant if you've got an injury. It has a very soothing feel if you use it as a plaster or a bandage. Now, who can remember what is the name of that plant? If you can, I'll be suitably impressed. And if you know that answer, send it through to the hashtag SafariLive. Now, Kyle's just reminded me of something quite important. Last year, today, was the first time we saw a woodlands kingfisher. Ooh, so the pressure is on. Will we find a woodlands today? Will the air become filled with the cacophony of ch-chirrs that we're going to experience for the next few months? Now, because of the incredibly dry period we've been through, there is a chance that the woodlands might come a little bit later. They might have spent a bit more time in Zambia or Botswana on their way down. They've had a bit more rain up there, so they could be a better reason to stay up there for a bit longer and feed up before heading down south here to us. Now all my impala hotspot seems to be devoid of impala. I wonder if it's because this is the area the dogs ran through yesterday and all the impala are still calming down and they're getting rid of their jittery nerves after wild dogs have been in the vicinity. Not very good visual of them, but there's a little herd of buffalo. They seem to have been spending quite a bit of time here. I think Jamie had them in the exact same place yesterday, hiding from the Nkuhumas. Can't really see them, they're just... let me try. There we go. It is a buffalo, I promise. There we go, now we can see it's a buffalo. Now, there is quite a lot of nice green grass up here on the crest. Maybe they're just staying here and taking advantage of that. Of course, the lion's on the other side of the reserve, so it's probably a good place to be if you're a buffalo. As I said, we're not going to go off-roading towards them. They are still quite skinny and probably a bit skittish, so we're just going to let them carry on feeding and continue on our adventures in search of elephants, baby impala, and woodlands kingfishers. So we've got one answer in already for the quiz. Is it an aloe? It is not an aloe at all. It does have a very juicy sap that is quite soothing, as I said, on burns or open wounds. They do get flowers, but it all depends on the rainfall whether they flower or not. Would like to know, is it a pygmy elephant ear? It is not, Marco, but that's a very, that's a good guess. You're getting into the right area. Nope, and something flew, and I was just trying to make sure it wasn't something really interesting. There we go. Well done, Bridget in Johannesburg, South Africa. You are spot on correct. It is indeed an arum lily. And they do come with a beautiful white flower. Sometimes they don't flower. It all depends on the amount of rainfall that falls. Now, while we look for the biggest animal out here, the African elephant, Steph is going to take you in to the other end of the spectrum, to something incredibly tiny.
What you're having a look at over here is a very rarely seen carrion... Keratin beetle. Excuse me. Keratin beetle. You've got an eye view of a keratin beetle eating the fur off a discarded impala skin. And this carcass is just full of them. We're going to pick it up now. I'm going to give the camera back to Brian. Where we're standing, the signal is bad. And so I was holding the camera, hence that little bit of a shaky one that you saw there. Now we'll zoom in. You can actually see the whole skin. And just have a look at it all, just covered. It's an old impala skin. Impala died here, and nothing came and ate it. But it has left the skin pretty much intact, which usually gets eaten by leopard or hyena or lion, and has allowed us this very rare view of these keratin beetles that have eaten, busy eating the fur, busy eating the hair. You can see where they have fed. The hair has been eaten clean, pretty much level with the rest of the carcass. And all this is left. A slow moving beetle, just quite content to chew the hair and to digest it. Here we're seeing, they've just finished mating as well. Also, another rare, we don't see this very often, everybody. It does, one stone and two cats. You've just said it looks like this beetle's wearing an army hat. It does look a little bit like a pith helmet. I must agree with you over there. But just marvel in the fact that what you're seeing here is quite rare. I mean, I'm thinking of the amount of times that I've actually seen this in my guiding career, probably less than 5 times, where you've seen so many keratin beetles at any one time. And that's usually because the impala skin gets eaten as part of the meal, and not much is left for these poor beetles. But yeah, we're having a look at interactions, fights over a good patch. See, he's making his advances over here. Shame. Can't even have a decent meal. I actually think he's just trying to dominate her. Let me see. I don't mean to intrude on their privacy here, but it's just behavior I've never seen before. No, it's definitely mating behavior. Ooh. That is just so bizarre. And I suppose with this resource actually being quite limited, I mean, you get a lot of horns lying around and they absolutely do feed on the horns, but hair is easily obtained. Much, much less hard than trying to chew through a horn. And I just think that this is probably, for these beetles, would be a feast and a collection point. And you'd probably find that because there are so many beetles here, it just gives the opportunity for them to socialize, do a bit of mass mating, I suppose, because everyone is here. It's just interesting, just the behavior that we can see here. It's just so unique to see, it's just nice. I don't know much more about keratin beetles. The only thing you really know about them is that they're only one of two species out here that do feed on keratin, and you don't really see them that often. Now when we're seeing them, I don't know much more about them at all. It's just, yeah. Suppose just take it in, enjoy it. What else can we do? Observe. All right. I think you've observed enough. we can carry on just before it gets going too much. We're still busy following these game paths sort of back into or back away from Sydney's dam. And we're dipping in and out of signal over here. So before we lose you again to a crash cut, I suppose, I'm going to send you over to Jamie.
We are still with the royal family. I'm making the absolute most of seeing my first leopards since I got back. And of course, very glad that it happened to be Karula and her family. I made a mistake earlier. I thought it was the head that Shungile had dropped and that Hosanna had taken the carcass away down with him and was hissing at her. I was completely mistaken. Now that we've repositioned and come in a little bit closer, I can see why Shungile was so very frustrated with the situation that she'd landed herself in, because it's not the head stuck between the branches, but the entire Nyala carcass. No wonder she was so cross with the fact that she couldn't actually get it. The head's rolled off down the hill and has been abandoned by the two young cubs. And in fact, Hosanna, I wrongly blamed him for taking the carcass away, but he hasn't had anything to do with it. He actually moved off when his sister came in, which, by the way, does take us back to Paul's question about the innate dominance of a male cub, because he clearly just wasn't too bothered with the idea of fighting with her. And he abandoned the kill and went off and left her to it. And he just actually wanted to go and nap down in the drainage line. I can't see him anymore. He's gone completely flat. Now, all in all, a very peaceful morning spent with our leopard family. Not so much for the poor Nyala, of course, but for our leopards, they are well fed and most content. And because they've got such round bellies, if it were a different situation, if they were hungry, we would be seeing a very different scene, especially if Karula were hungry, because she could finish off that entire Nyala herself in the matter of hours. If it were a different situation, I might say to you that there's a chance they will have moved before the sunset safari this afternoon or by tomorrow, but I actually think they're going to stick around. I think they're going to be here for the next few hours, and maybe even if we're really lucky, they might be here until tomorrow morning. It just depends on what happens. Which actually was a completely useless sentence, I'm sorry. It just depends on what happens. Well, obviously it does. That was really profound, Jamie. A truly profound sentence. We never would have guessed that. My apologies. Lots of hoisting trees, if Karula bothers with it, but I don't think she will. We're actually in such a beautiful area. We're sort of tucked away under the safety of a combination of bush willows, leadwoods, and tambuertes. It was a bit of a tricky area to get into, with the guari bushes sort of dangling over our heads. Pervium was showered by the tree. Was it water or was it leaves, or a combination of both? Water. It's the joy of the post-rain drive. Even if it's not raining on you, as soon as you drive under a tree and the antenna knocks the tree, you end up getting showered. Which has always been a fun game. I don't know if you ever played this when you were kids, or perhaps even now when you're adults, but going up to someone when they're standing under a tree and just pulling the branch and showering them. Well, that happens almost inevitably here. I noticed the cubs were looking a little bit soggy earlier, but they seem to have dried out completely. Oh, flies. So irritating, hey girl? I love the way that their muscles twitch like that instinctively. She is so much smaller than her brother. But those big feet, those massive feet, do give an indication as to just how much more she has to grow. I wonder if she's going to be bigger than her mom. Hey, little brown-eyed girl. Oh, big yawn. Is it time to make another go of it? Time to see if you can get that out of there. Problem solve. You got it in there, Shungile. It might come out exactly the same way you managed to get it in there if you managed to figure that out. Not quite worth the bother right at this moment. A lazy lion day. Lie-in day, not lion day. These are leopards. I called her the brown-eyed girl earlier. She didn't quite retain that incredible hazel colour that she had to her eyes when we first started seeing them properly, though. It wasn't even hazel, actually. It was a deep chocolate brown. I'd never seen that on a leopard cub before. It's quite an unusual eye colour for leopards. And they've become a lot greener in colour. She didn't keep it, but they were beautiful. They're still beautiful. Just not quite as unusual as the eye colour that she was born with. Fascinating how they change. Thank you for rolling over, girl. Actually gives us a really beautiful view. Little bloody patches on her elbows. Still fluffy. Still fluffier than mom. Just that little bit. Retaining that downy cub layer. And I always find it incredibly special that they feel comfortable enough with us to sleep this deeply with us right next to them. And she is fast asleep. It's amazing how fast they fall asleep as well. From awake to asleep and awake again in a matter of seconds. That is definitely not something I am able to do. I don't know if any of you perhaps have the napping abilities of cats, but I certainly do not. And that ability to wake up as quickly as they do as well, which I suppose is most essential out here. And as beautiful Shungile snoozes away, it seems as though Brent has found something arguably almost as pretty.
Look at that, the rain has brought out one of my favorite things, flowers! And this is the first lilies of the season, and they are crinum lilies. I'm coming to have a closer look to see which crinum. Now, there are two main species of crinum we get here. There are a lot of crinum lilies around, and I'm trying to see. So what we're looking for in the one type of lily is there's normally a little pink line on the inside, and that's called a candy striped crinum. This doesn't seem to have the candy stripe, so I think this is probably a river crinum, which is the other more common species here. Now, when handling these type of things, you got to be quite careful because they are quite noxious. The sap can be very, very, very nasty. But if you touch the flower, it's fine, but it's if you get any of the sap or in the bulb. Now, there's another one here. Ooh, I'm going to turn this one to you because it's reproducing parts are still looking quite fresh. This one, it looks like some of the insects have fed off that already. Oh, let me try to keep still. There we go. There's a bit of wind. But look at that. Absolutely beautiful. Crinum lilies. Now, I am on the lookout for flowers always. And as I said, after the rain, it's going to take a little while. But I think in the next couple of days, we're going to see lots of wonderful flowers. And great to start off with the probably the largest of the lilies we get here, the crinum lily. Now, because it's been so dry, I'm really, really hoping that for the first time on Juma, I'm going to see a fireball lily. Now, doesn't that sound fantastic? We'll definitely be keeping a very sharp lookout for them. But if you want to have a look what a fireball lily looks like, just Google a fireball lily or African fireball lily, and you should see the picture. Now, it's just basically this ball of little red flowers, and it's exquisitely beautiful. But we're going to carry on towards quarantine. We still haven't found any impalas. That's very strange. When you look for impalas, you can't find them. When you're not looking for impalas, they're everywhere. Now, look at that already. That crinum, there's another crinum here. These ones are already been, looks like they're pollinated and have already just flopped down to the ground. So quite often with a lot of the lilies and stuff like that, they don't last very long. Oh my, let's just go forward a bit, Shonda. I spotted something else. No, sorry, false alarm. Now, I think one of the next flowers we might see is, there's two. They look quite similar. One is the roadside pimpernel, and the other is the lion's eye. Now, you gotta look carefully because the flowers look very similar, but if you start looking at the leaves, they're quite different. Now, we didn't have a great flower season last year because of the drought, so I'm hoping we get a much better flower season. Now, one of the fascinating things about a lot of the flowers, and especially after a long drought like that, we might see flowers we've never seen before. Some flower species will only come out every 10 years, every 20 years, every 8 years. So really exciting. So I'm definitely going to be keeping a very close eye, whoopsie, there goes my door, on the ground and on the beautiful flowers that we get here out in the African bush. It is a bit of a pet passion of mine, wild flowers. Okay. I'm keep checking now. Now after the crinums, I'm looking at every little patch of grass, every bit of patch of ground, trying to see some flowers. Now, as I said, we should be getting the lion's eye hibiscus is another one, a different lion's eye, a big yellow flower, a creeper, that should also be coming out. The morning glories should be coming out, the lamb's tails and the heliotropes, and of course the large devil thorn. I'm trying to think what else is probably going to see. Oh, pink bells, hymenias should be coming soon as well as anthericums. So I'm really hoping, especially if this overcast weather continues for a bit longer, giving those plants a chance to explode out in absolute wonder. But as of yet, there's very, very few, but they could be coming soon. Okay, well, I get so excited about flowers, so I'm going to go keep looking for flowers for the last little bit of the safari, and while Jandre and I do that, let's go see how Steph's getting on Shank's pony.
And from flowers and flowers, looking at another hunter of flowers, this millipede, they do eat flowers from time to time. And just another one of the fantastical creatures that live here in the bush with us. And we found something. This is a zebra wood that managed to survive the drought against all odds and pretty much intact. Hasn't been fed on much by anything, and I'm hoping it stays that way. These poor trees get absolutely hammered by elephant, and this one looks to have survived it by some miracle. So I'm just sharing some time with this tree and giving it some congratulatory thanks and well wishes. You know, just these energy flows out here are pretty good. And it's come to that part of the tow where we have to say goodbye, unfortunately. You know, one of those things. We have got a closed show this evening, so we'll catch you again for a walk tomorrow morning on the AM Safari. I just want to say thank you very much for the support. Brian just wants to say thank you as well. We had some fun today on the walk with you, and we'll catch you again soon. Hope you have a nice day wherever you are.
And she's here. Three. Sorry, everybody. I'm just having a quick chat with one of the other vehicles to let them know exactly where the leopards are. So just bear with me one moment. Yeah, there's Karula's there, and then the two cubs are here. What we're going to be doing is in the next few minutes we'll move out and give them our position so that they can see a little bit more clearly. Since we have got the best view in the house, I think, of beautiful Shungile. My brother's slightly more hidden. And then Mom, of course, is completely flat. So Shungile tried one more time to get that Nyala carcass out. And she just had no success. Thoroughly frustrating, isn't it, girl? We were just chatting a little bit earlier about the sheer power of these animals' reflexes, the speed. The fact that that kill happened so incredibly quickly. She must have just stumbled upon them and grabbed that Nyala. Oh, look, 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 look. You see the double canine? She's growing her permanent teeth. She's got two canines. That is adorable. I love it when they have that. Her baby canines are still in, and she's got it on the top, on her top canines. She's actually got a double set. The permanent teeth are growing. And she's got a double set of canines. I think that her son has actually got his permanent teeth now. But Shungile still hasn't lost her baby teeth. And as a result, she's a little bit like a shark. She's got two rows of teeth. Come on, you want to... Okay, no, she's busy digging now. Making sandcastles. I hope some of you managed to get a screenshot of that yawn. You'll be able to go back and double check, but I'm pretty sure I saw two canines there. At least in the top left corner, and I think in the top right as well. How amazing is that? Just like your puppies and your kittens at home. Look at the fine, sensitive hairs on the inside of her ears. Well, these cameras allow us the most phenomenal views, and what an incredibly exciting morning it has been for us at least. And for the leopards of Juma. From the excitement of earlier in the hunt and the playing, now just to these restful and very, very peaceful scenes in what is a truly stunning setting. She's already inherited her mom's poise. And perhaps it's just a leopard thing. The dignity of their postures. And those ears constantly twisting and turning, listening to the sounds around her. I think she's bored. I think she wants to. She wants to play. It's not too hot, but her brother's asleep, her mom's asleep, and the carcass is unreachable. I'm looking for things to keep herself entertained. Now, Shamsun, you wanted to know if there is no sunset drive this afternoon. Shamsun, unfortunately not. It is a private rehearsal, and we do thank you and really appreciate your patience with these rehearsals. We do have very good reasons in order to do them, and of course, we will be having the televised broadcast to the United States tomorrow afternoon on our sunset drive. So no, there will be no sunset drive this afternoon. We've got a lot to sort out, lots and lots to do. all kinds of things to get our wrap our brains around. So we thank you for your patience and, as always, your unending support in terms of the steps that Safari Live has taken. And for those of you that are not in the US, who will not be able to see it televised, you will, of course, always be able to watch it on the normal means over the internet. And, of course, you don't have to worry about ad breaks. So there you go. And on that note, that draws to a close a very special, very emotional in a way, a sunrise safari. And it's time for us to do our goodbyes and our thank yous. So a big thank you to Viam, as always, for his wonderful camera work and, of course, being on the ball with the more frantic moments of this morning's leopard hunt. And, of course, a thank you to Rebecca and to Kirsty in Final Control. And most importantly, a big thank you to all of you watching across the globe. Thank you for sending through your questions and your comments. And, of course, for sharing in these special moments with us. And now for the last few seconds of the show, I think we should finish off with a view of the beautiful Shongile as she rests in the grey morning light. What a special way to enjoy a time with a very special leopard family. Bye-bye.